Don't you just hate it, men? Because we have such big pockets that you kind of forget stuff is there until it gets a little uncomfortable? It's that way for me all the time. Oh, hang on. Another RX Vega 56. All jokes aside, I have a lot of RX Vega 56 and 64 cards. I'm not gonna tell you how much, because that's none your business, but long story short, I will say that I do have 12 of this particular Powercolor Red Dragon RX Vega 56 that I've purchased all at the same time. Now, I've been using them to run a bit of a mining experiment, and not just an experiment to see, you know, how much crypto I could make, but actually something productive for the channel that will probably come out sometime in March or February. What I can do with these cards that some of those other YouTubers can't is test to see how much overclocking you can get from one card to the next, all within the same model, on the same BIOS, in the same room with the same temperature, the same power supply, and the same cooler. Basically, what I'm getting at is if you buy enough scratch-off tickets, you'll eventually win the silicon lottery. So let's take a look and see what the distribution is of good overclockers to bad overclockers, and what kind of range of overclock you could expect to get in Unigen Superposition with this particular GPU.
With RX Vega, it is often more beneficial to overclock your memory than it is the core itself. Nevertheless, we still got an average of 955 to 960 MHz for each of the GPUs we tested. A couple of them did overclock up to 985, which was awesome, but on the other hand, we had a couple that couldn't go over 940, so that was a bit of a bummer too. And if we take a look at core overclocking results, we can see that basically all of them hit about 1600 MHz or higher when running Unigen Superposition without crashing. One of them did manage to beat 1650, which was awesome, but it looks like the low 1600s is probably what you can expect for your own Vega card. Now, while all of that data is nice, something else I really wanted to see is if there was a correlation between overclocking on the core versus the maximum overclock you could achieve on the memory. If we take a look at the worst memory overclockers down at the bottom, we can see that they're about average, maybe a little higher, when it comes to core overclocking. And if we take a look at the worst core overclockers at the far left, we can see that they're slightly below average for memory overclocking. And of course, the last thing I learned from all this is which graphics cards need to get sold on eBay and which ones need to go back into a mining rig. For science, of course.
In the off chance another manufacturer of a video card would like to show off how well binned a particular model of GPUs and they'd like to loan me a dozen to sample, I'd be more than happy to make a video on that. But for the rest of you guys, if you like this sort of content, leave a like. If you'd like to see me test other models of RX Vega 56 to see what the distribution of their overclocking stability is, then let me know in the comments below. If you want to see more stuff with video cards, because clearly there's no shortage of video cards to make content with, then make sure to get subscribed to this channel. And if video cards are just something you need your fix of now because you're addicted, like not me, then check out these other videos. Meanwhile, I have some empty mining rigs that need to be used for science and not personal gain, so I'm gonna go work on that. Until then, see you in the next one.